guess I'm going to walk. Oh, that milky white way. Oh, child, some of these days. Well, I'm going to walk that milky white way. Oh, some of these days. Well, 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 I'm going to walk up and take up my stand. Gonna join that Christian band. I'm going to walk, whoa, that milky white way. Oh Lord, some of these days I'm gonna tell my, oh, my mother, howdy, 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 when I get home. Yes, I'm going to tell my mother howdy when I get home. Well, well, well.
Yesterday, when it is past and gone, and as a watch in the night, you sweep men away in the sleep of death. They are like the new grass in the morning, though in the morning it springs up new. By evening, it is cut down and withered. For we are consumed by your anger, terrified by your indignation. You have set our iniquities before you, and our secret sin in the light of thine countenance. The length of our days Severton, or Aiden, your posture, your disfavor, for trouble and sorrow, for they could be pass, and we flower. That is due to you. So teach us, O God, to number our days, that we may gain a heart of wisdom. Relent, O Lord, how long will you have compassion on us? Satisfy us, yearning with thy mercy. Make us glad according to the days wherein thou hast given us. For as many years as we have seen trouble, may we be shown to your servant. Yes. Thank you.
for me. Jesus, we am. Oh, Jesus, we am. Say, when I'm in trouble, he gives me a song. And in the night season, say when I'm in trouble, he gives me a song, and in the night season, and all the day long, oh, then who makes me do right when I would do wrong? Yeah. Because he said he
The Lord is in his holy temple, that the whole earth keeps silent before him. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. My brothers and sisters, as we come down to witness the homegoing of Reverend Moses B. Meta, I'm asking that you would be, please, ma'am, and please, sirs, as kind as possible. And we also ask that you would do what the family has requested. You know, sometimes we kind of take over a program and do our own thing. But we're asking you, please, ma'am, and please, sirs, be kind. And if I stand up, that means you've been up too long. Hallelujah. Let's walk this family through this, because one day, we will have to sit where they are sitting now. I'm going to announce just maybe two things, and then from that point forward, I'm going to ask that all persons on the order of worship, please respond to your name. We'll begin with a prayer, scripture reading, and a hymn. In that order, please.
Bless the name of the Lord, for he is great, and he is greatly to be praised. Hallelujah. We honor God today, and we give him thanks for a life that crossed our path in some kind of way. I praise God for this mother. I praise God for the husband. I praise God for each of you in your respective places. Let us pray today. And as we pray, we just want to think about this family and what they need from the Lord in this hour. So, Heavenly Father, as we come before your presence today, Lord, we come honoring your name, Lord, because you are great and you are a mighty God. God, you have brought us to this time, Lord. And Lord, we just believe you, God, to show your purpose, Lord God, for this hour. I pray now, Lord, for this family, God. I pray that you will strengthen them. I pray that you will give them courage, Lord God, to move forward in you, to know that you are still God and you are still on the throne, Lord God. We pray today, Lord God, for them, Lord God, that their heads may be lifted up, Lord God. And Lord God, that you might come in to them and sup with them, God. We pray today that the joy of the Lord will fill their hearts, oh God, in this hour of sadness and bereavement, God. Pray that you will strengthen this mother, strengthen her husband, God, strengthen the son, God. I pray now, Lord God, that this entire family will be strengthened from on high. God, we thank you for these services today that you are presenting before us. And I pray that our hearts will be touched, that we will be moved, God, to see your glory, your greatness in the midst of us. We thank you, Father, for what you are about to do in this time right here, right now. In Jesus' name we do pray and give you glory. And all of those that know the Lord said, amen.
Our scripture reading from the Old Testament, Lamentations chapter number 3, beginning at verse 22. The word of God says, through the Lord's mercies, we are not consumed. because his compassions fail not. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, says my soul. Therefore, I hope in him. The Lord is good to those who wait for him, to the soul who seeks him. It's good that one should hope and wait quietly for the salvation of the Lord. Verse 31 says, for the Lord will not cast off forever. Though he causes grief, yet he will show compassion according to the multitude of his mercies. For he does not afflict willingly, nor grieve the children of men. This is God's word.
Thessalonians chapter number 4, beginning at verse 13. We'll be reading from the King James Version of the Bible. And it reads, but I would not have you ignorant, to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, that you sorrow not, even as others which have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so then also which sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with a voice of an archangel, and with the trump of God. And the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up into them with in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we ever be with the Lord. Wherefore, comfort one another these words. The word of God to the people of God. Amen. God bless you.
Good afternoon. Stepping in for Pastor Warren today to sing the hymn. And one of the old hymns of the church, hymn number 454, says, charge to keep I have, and a God to glorify, every dying soul to save, and fit it for the sky. And I know that during Reverend Maddox's time in ministry, he has sung this hymn all over. And so today, if you know the words of this hymn, we're going to ask those of you to help sing along with us. In the Baptist hymnal, it is sung in a short meter. Now, some of you probably don't know what that means, but we will give you a crash course on short meter hymns today. To keep Son my soul to save and pin it for the sky. Ooh, yeah, yeah. Sung autumn, say, and oh yeah, to serve the present age, my calling to fulfill, to serve. That's what we all gotta do. Thank you, Lord. To do my master's will. Oh, may
a one-of-a-kind man. He was one-of-a-kind. If you knew him, I don't know how you couldn't love him. He was going to make you laugh. He was going to connect you to somebody. He made sure I knew his family, his mother's extended family. He made sure that my siblings and I were connected, even from a young age. We didn't grow up in the same household, but we made up for that time as best we could in our adulthood. And these last few years have been so special. I wanted to say, there's so much he talked to me about that he wanted me to say, but a lot of those things were funny things that I would never repeat. But he just wanted to make me laugh. But most of all, I just wrote a couple notes and I'm gonna sit down. But I wanted to just say he was God's child. He always told me that I loved him at his core. And I saw who he was on the inside.
We all fall short of God's glory, but he knew the Lord, and he wanted to make sure other people knew God. I'm gonna miss him, but I have a whole virtual box full of fun times that I will always reflect on. So many things that we said together. The phone calls when I was coming into town. Where you at? Come pick me up. We were riding together, we were eating together, we were laughing about everything until we were coughing and choking. And so that is what I want to remember most about my brother, is his hearty laugh, how he loved on people. He loved his family. I can't say that enough. He bragged on everybody, his nephews, his nieces, his siblings, everybody. He loved all of you. And I'm glad he introduced me to those I didn't know. And I just want to say we're going to miss him.
Good evening. Morning, evening, not sure what time of the day it is. My cousin. My eyes filled with tears as I heard the news. It never occurred to me how much we was about to lose. I find myself wishing that it wasn't real, because every time I thought about it, pain was all I felt. Tears fell from my eyes. I could barely see. But my heart tells me that Mosey will always be with me. I'm glad he feel no pain now. He live in a perfect land, because now he's resting in God's loving hands. People may never know how much Mosey meant to me and you. They knew him by name, but that's still not the same. His eyes so wide, his smile so wide. We always let him knew we was right there by his side. Now he's gone for me and you. Now we have no reason to be blue. But his memory will never leave. His kind and gentle smile will always be seen. Never forget him. Never let him leave your mind. Tell him you love him just one more time. I love you, Moses. All of my great memories lies with Benoit's name. B for brilliant. Benoit was a brilliant and clever person. Very exceptionally talented and clever. E for educated. Educated and wise beyond his years. N was for nice, and I know naughty with his comments sometimes. The ones that he made us laugh when he began to leave my grandmother's house about Sabrina and her kids. He would always come out and say, Sabrina ain't doing nothing with them boys. And ambition. He was ambition. He was willing. He wanted to succeed at everything he partaked. He was a remarkable young man. For those who knew him, he stood out in a crowd. D was for determined. Denard was determined to get it right with his God. Now, my most fondly memory was when Nard, we had revival at our church one year. It was youth revival. And Nard came to our church, and he gave us the most heartfelt revival that week. And when we left every night, we would get together and talk about what Nard had sang about and what Nard had talked about. One thing Nard was good at, he was good at singing. And when you knew when he grabbed that ear, he was finna take you on a journey, an unforgettable journey. And I love to hear him sing, and that will always live with me. So in my closing, I hope only that we find some comfort and consolation in our own warm memory of Bernard. I love you, family.
to the family. God's a battle axe in the time of a battle. God's a battle axe in the time of a battle. God's a battle axe in the time of war. God's a shelter in the time of storm. One Sunday morning, years ago, a tall, slim young man walked into the Beulah Grove Baptist Church and stole my heart and stole the heart of everyone he came in contact with. He had a way with people. He was funny, but friendly. He made a connection with the young and the young at heart. He knew the word and he knew God. And he had an uncanny way of presenting that word. Bernard also had another gift, the gift of song. If he did not catch you, your attention with the word or his wit and amusing behavior, his gift of song did. His voice was sweet and he sang from his heart. He was the same every time you met him. His conversations would draw you in no matter what the topic was. His personality just engulfed you. Bernard lit up the room whenever he entered it. There was nothing fancy about Bernard. He was just Bernard. It is with much sadness that he's no longer with us. But because we knew him and shared his love for Christ, that we know we will all be united with him again. Again, God's a battle axe in the time of a battle. God's a battle axe in the time of a battle. God's a battle axe in the time of war. God's a shelter in the time of storm. His shelter took him home out of the storm.
Somebody that's with you through thick and thin over the years. Moses Bernard Maddox, that was my friend. I first met Bernard when we were going to ninth grade. He was going to start going to the city schools. He had been going to the county school. We low-key thought Bernard was rich because his granddaddy paid tuition for him to go to the city school. And you know, we hung out all that summer. We hung out during the school year. We hung out singing in the youth choir. We went to Wendy's and ate lots of fries and frosties. Bernard could eat his weight in fries and frosties. We ate at Pasquale's. We were inseparable for several years. And we even went on to college together. Now, let me tell you about my friend Bernard. I called him one night because I had broken up with my boyfriend. And I said, Nard, I broke up with my boyfriend. And he listened to me. And he let me talk a long time. And then he said, now, boo, because that's what he called me, my nickname. He said, boo, you got to quit all that crying now. Get over that boy. He ain't worth all that. Y'all know he said it just like that. He said, I'm going to come tomorrow. We're going to go to Albany. We're going to go to the mall. We're going to go out to eat. I said, okay, Bernard. The next day, he came and got me. Before I could get in the car, he said, and don't get in here with all that crying, because we're going to have a good day. You know what? We had a good day. And that was just one example. Another time back in 1990, my brother died, and I had been out of work the entire week dealing with my brother's death. And I went back to work on a Monday, and I was just so emotional at my job, and people were giving me their condolences. I couldn't make it that Tuesday. I didn't go to work that Tuesday. Now, I don't how Bernard knew to call me, but he called me that Tuesday night. He said, I'm just calling to check on you. I said, no, I ain't have no good day. And he talked me through it. He said, let me tell you something. He said, you know, I know her daddy died. He said, you got some more crying days ahead of you. He said, but you gonna be all right. You trust in the Lord. And it seemed like a cloud just lifted off of me. And I went to work that next day, and I had some more crying days ahead of me now. But I made it. I made it on those words that Bernard gave me. He was so wise from the time we were like 14 years old. I mean, he was all of our spiritual leaders, our counselors, our confidants. And sometimes he thought he was our dad. And I remember one time when my sister was in the hospital, we were in she was in intensive care in Albany. We look up Miss Sarah coming through the door. Miss Sarah said, Bernard sent me. Because that's what he did. He always looked out for us. I got 100 of those stories. But you know what? He didn't just do it for me. He did it for so many people because that was who he was. He cared about people. When he was your friend, he was your friend through thick and thin. I would never forsake the Lord because he has got me through so many tough times. That was my friend. But before I take my seat though, I got to tell y'all about the time that he left me going to school. So me and Bernard had a falling out the day before. He said, I ain't going to come and pick you up, take you to school. And I had a lot of mouth. I said, I bet you will. You know, he had a lot of mouth. He said, I can show you better than I can tell you. So I'm sitting there on Jackson Street, waiting on Bernard to come down the street, and I see him. And I get my books together, you know, ready to get in that car. Bernard passed right on by my car. I said, that boy done left me. And I get to school. Now, we got the same class. We stayed together all day, so I don't know how he thought he could afford it. We had it out. But you know, by lunchtime, we back friends. Because that's what real friends are. Who think and think. So to the family, I give you my sincere condolences. Bernard was family to us. He could come in our house without knocking. Not ringing the doorbell, just walking. On behalf of the class of 1984 from America's High, you will miss our classmates. To you, Lord, I see you on the other side. Thank you.
Made a practical to always celebrate our birthday together. We were very proud of Moses, and I loved calling him when he began preaching. In the teen years, he made us proud, and boy, did he fill the church up. He would preach the roof off the church, and he would not even talked about how he would raise a hymn. He was a character, always made us laugh and would cook us meals out of the world. God gave him so many gifts. A preacher, singer, great cook, and a landscaper. He knew his family history. We know that we could always call on Moses if you needed to know anything about the family, and he would go a way back. He loved his family, and God know we love him. More of all, his love, he loved the Lord. Today I say, fly high, cousin. Take your rest from trouble of the world. We love you, but God love you best.
God our Father and our Keeper, to this family, you know, I've been trying to figure out what I need to say, but I think I can just sum it all up in a few words. Bernard was just Bernard. And then he's one of my sons while he was at the Grove that I don't care how hard I try to be mad with him, it wouldn't last. So what shall I say? Let me just say just a word to the family. There's a story. I love stories. Of a preacher by the name of George Weaver. The story is, Sister Sarah, that Dr. Weaver and his family was on their way to revival. When they stepped into the car, the sun was shining, the wind was blowing, the birds were singing. But as they proceeded down the road, a storm hit. His daughter was driving and his wife was sitting comfortably in the back seat. And that storm rocked the car. Matter of fact, the storm was so bad. The storm was so hard that folk was pulling over because you couldn't see the road. His daughter said, "Dad," talking to Reverend Weaver, "should I pull over?" He said, "No, baby, drive on." The storm drew work. He said, "Daddy, I can't see." And he said, "The Lord will make a way." He says, "Drive on." And all of a sudden, the storm stopped. The sun reappeared. And he says, "Now, baby, pull over." He said, "I got something I need to tell you." He says, "All those folk that pull over in the storm, they are still," y'all ain't gonna help me, "in the storm." That's what I wanna leave with the family. That's the word I wanna leave with. It's rough now. It's tough now, Sister Sarah. It's hard, but you gotta drive on. When family members get discouraged, you got to encourage one another. And when all others fail, call on him. I wish I could holler. He's able, I tell you. He's able. Let me leave that alone. The preacher's coming with the eulogy. But I'm sure enough tempted. Hallelujah, somebody.
Just before I come, we have another selection by Bishop Carson.
Again, we give honor to God. You know, Bernard was part of our church and a part of our church choir. And one of the songs that he used to sing was this song about God is my everything. Why don't y'all just put your hands together? Look at somebody and say, neighbor, God is my everything. How many of y'all believe that today? Come on, put your hand together. He's my joy. He's my hope. Oh, he's my will. Shelter. Oh, God is. God is my everything. Oh, God is. God is. He's my joy. He's my hope. He's my joy. In a weird chapter. Oh, God is my everything. Oh, God is my everything. God is my everything. He's my joy. He's my hope. He's my rocker in the weary land. Shelter. Oh, God is. Can I get a witness? God is my everything. Oh, my everything. Joy in sorrow. Hope, talk to Bob. Doctor in a sick room. Lawyer in a cold room. Anybody here know Jesus? Anybody here know Jesus? My everything. If you know Jesus here, your everything. Let me hear you say everything. Let me hear you say everything. My everything. God is.
God is, God is my everything.
Right here, this is where we got to give God some praise in this place. Anybody that knew my brother knew that he loved to give God some praise. So we got to give God some praise in this place. Okay, if you don't want to praise him, I'll give him some praise. The word says the rocks will cry out if you don't. I'm going to give God some praise because I'm here. I'm on this side of living. So I'm going to give God some praise. Now, if you want to join me, you're welcome to do that. But I'm going to give God some praise. Father, we just thank you. We honor you, God. We give you glory. We magnify you, Lord. We lift you up in this place, God. We know that we're not in a building, but we are the church, oh God. So God, we'll give you glory. We'll magnify you. We'll lift your name, oh God. Oh God, we thank you. We thank you. We thank you. Okay, I got to pull back just a little bit. Woo. Ah. Ah. Yeah. All right. All right. All right. All right. Don't y'all push me. Hallelujah. Okay, you act like you can't praise him. That's all right. That's all right. I'm going to give him some praise for you. How about that? Because if you knew Bernard, you knew he loved to praise. So let's give God some praise, I said, in this place. All right. All right. Let me get myself together. So we have a modification. And that's okay, because my mom would like to have some words and my sister would also like to have some words following her.
Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Thank you, God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, God. Thank you, Lord. I said to God, be the Lord.
Amen. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Glory to God. I tell you, this is my firstborn. And this little boy, when he was a little boy, if he learned a hymn, he would raise it. I said, to God be the glory. And see, mama couldn't sing like he sung. But they'll tell me to stay in my path. But I get out of my path, because I felt like I could sing too. I felt like I could do it just like they could do it. I said, glory to God. All five of them, when I said could sing, they can sing. My husband can sing. I'm the only one in the house they can't sing. Couldn't sing. But I said, I sing like I sing. That's what I said. I sing like I sing. And I tell you, I was saying my own self happy. I said, to God be the glory. As I've already said, Bernard was somebody in God. Yes, he had some failure. Because guess what? I failed God too. Show me somebody ain't failed God. And I'll show you somebody lying. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God have never failed me. Never, never, never failed me. I failed him, but he never failed me. I said to God, be the glory. I have a word I believe from the Lord. I'm not going to preach. I'm going to just read the word. Because the word of God is true all by itself. When God said, in the beginning, it was true. And at the end, it was amen, it was true. Amen. Throughout Genesis to Revelation, the word is true. Amen. One day I was sitting, I was much younger, and God, the Spirit said to me, there are positive and negative. But guess what? All the negatives was true in the word, because God left it just for us. Just for us. And I was at the house, I think it was before Bernard passed, praise God, I got a call. The nurse said, Mr. Maddox said, call you Mr. Carson. She gave him the phone. And I said, hey baby, how you doing today? It was a whisper. God, oh God, I'm all right, Mama. That was it. He gave the phone back to the nurse. All right. And the nurse said, Miss Carson, you can come. But I couldn't go. I couldn't go. Because I wanted to go so bad, I was in tears. But I had to think about me and the family. And I believe Bernard wanted me to do that. He wanted me to come. He didn't never say come, he just spoke. He wanted me to come. I wanted to go, but I didn't go. So that was on Monday. Tuesday, I was in the kitchen. I was fixing dinner. I said to my husband, I said, I am so tired. But it wasn't from work. I was just tired. I began to cry. I said, I want to go see my baby. My husband said, I don't think you need to go. So that was that. I'm one that honor what my husband say. Sometimes I might not like it, but if he said, I honor. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. So I went on to bed Tuesday night. My prayer hour was at 3:00 in the morning. I woke up at 2:30. I wouldn't get up right then, and most of the time when I wake up, if I don't get up, I might fall back off to sleep. And I wake up a little before 3, but this time I didn't wake up till 3:30. I got up. I went to my prayer room. I began to talk to God about Bernard. I said, God, you said whatever I ask you, you said you would do it. If I doubt and believe not. I said, you said in your word, I gave him his word, not my words, but his word. I said, you said in your word, whatever I ask you, you would do it. If I believed and doubted not. And I'm not doubting this morning. I said, I'm praying to you, your word. I prayed his word. I gave him his word, y'all. I gave him his word. And I know what my baby was looking like the last time I seen him when he was went to the hospital. He was walking, but he wasn't walking. He was. I said, God, thank you. See, the word tells us to give thanks in all things. Some of us want to just give thanks for the good things. But God didn't tell us to give thanks for the bad things. He said, in all things. Am I in the word? He said, all things. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. God is faithful in all his ways. All his ways. If God said it, it's going to happen. It might not happen when you think it ought to happen. But I remember when he told me, he said, you're going to see Bernard delivered. But he didn't tell me how he was going to do it. But I said, to God be the glory. To God be the glory. He delivered him. Bernard is free, y'all. Yes. I ain't got no heaven to put him in. And I ain't got got no hair to put him in. But I have the word of God on it. Hallelujah. He said to me, Mama, I want you. He began to just talk and drop little bits and pieces. I want you to go buy you a beautiful black suit. I knew what he was saying, but to God be the glory. To God be the glory. I didn't buy the suit, but I bought a dress because I just couldn't find the suit. That was the only reason I didn't get it. He was just dropping little bits and pieces. In so many words, he was letting me know, I'm getting out of here, Mama. I said to him one day, I said, baby, just repent, forgive yourself. And as I started to say a little bit ago about how I prayed, and I was telling God to draw him to him, I got a call that morning at 9 o'clock. It was a doctor, it wasn't a nurse. And he said, Miss Carson. No, he didn't call me Miss Carson, he said Sarah. I said, yeah, this is Sarah. And he started talking about, did I want this to happen if he stopped breathing? I said, huh, baby, you talk to him. I didn't want to talk. And then told my husband, and he just said, I said, yeah. You know what? I believe when that doctor was talking to me, Bernard was dead then, but he wouldn't tell me. He said, I called back in 15 minutes. Between 15 and 20 minutes, we got a call. He said he couldn't bring him back. So we went, Kenny, Bernard, Dad, and my God, beautiful God daughter. We went, she went with me. When we got in that room, my baby laying up there dead, but I saw him resting in peace. I ain't talking about they done dressed him at the funeral home. I'm talking about he laying in the hospital bed. And I began to talk to him. And my guard daughter said, Mama, talk, he hear you. I kept on talking. And then after I finished talking, I spoke to him about my mom, my dad, Mayran, Leela. I said, and James. But Mayran's name was at the end. I said, your auntie Mayran, because everybody in this room, if they knew Mayran.
That's right.
If they knew Mayran. It was like he was hers more so than he was mine.
That's right.
We loved Bernard. We loved Bernard. And so I went to the left of the bed, because I was on the right at first. I went to the left of the bed, and Jesse was standing there by me. And my goddaughter said, Mama, you want to close his eyes? I didn't realize his eye was going to close so easy. I just closed the left one, and she closed the right one. I saw the peace of God on my baby. See, they don't like for me to call them baby, but all five of my babies. I don't care how old they are, they're my babies. Now I'm going into the word. Just a little bit of the word. You got it. Thank you, Lord. And this is what it said. I'm coming from Romans, the 10th chapter. I'm just going to read the word to you. That's all I got for your family. Take the word of God. This was what God was saying to Israel. They needed the gospel. We are family and friends. We need the true gospel of the word.
Amen.
See, we get some word, but it's so mixed with everything else, it can't bring deliverance.
All
right. I'm talking about the truth of the word.
Yeah.
The word is true, family.
Yeah.
So many are just religious, but we need to get away from that.
All right,
we need the truth of the word.
Yeah.
Thank you, God. Yeah. Reading from chapter 10 of Romans. This was talking about the Israelite needed the gospel. Almost said to the body of Christ, we have people giving the word, but they got too much mixtures in. I always said this, and then I'm going to read and sit down. I've been washed in the blood of the Lamb. I'm sanctified through the word. Now I'm reading. This was to Israel, but I'm going to say this is to us today. Brethren, my heart desire and prayer to God for Israel, for us, is that we may be saved. Glory to God. For I bear them witness that they have a zeal for God, but not according to knowledge. My God, the word is true, y'all. For they being ignorant of God's righteousness and seeking to establish their own righteousness, have not submitted to the righteousness of God. For Christ is the end of the law, for righteousness to everyone who believes. For Moses writes about the righteousness which is of the law, the man who does those things shall live by them. But the righteousness of faith speak in this way. Do not say in your heart, who will ascend unto heaven? That is to bring Christ down from above. Or who will descend into the abyss? That is to bring Christ up from the dead. But what does it say? The word is near you, in your mouth and in your heart. That is the word of faith which we preach. That if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus, that God has raised, let me read it right. Thank you, Lord. That if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God have raised him from the dead, you will be saved. It's simple. Confess. Believe in your heart. It's simple, family. It's simple, friends. Thank you, Lord. For with the heart, one believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth, confession is made unto salvation. For the scriptures say, whoever believed on him will not be put to shame. For there is no distinction between Jews and Greeks. For the same Lord over all is rich to all who call upon him. God loved the Israelite, but guess what? He loved it us too. He loved it us because he gave his son and he gave his life that we could have life and have it more abundant. Let us not be like the Israelite were. They rejected. Israel rejected the gospel. Let's receive the gospel of Jesus Christ. Let's, men and women that are preaching the word of God, if God give you the word and says, stand up and read it from Genesis to Revelation, do it. Do it. One Sunday I had prepared to minister the word of God. I had my message ready, but God said no. He said, read my word to my people. And as I began to read, he took me throughout the scripture, different scriptures, even took me to Revelation, and I began to read. And he said, those that read Revelation were blessed, but the hearers would be also blessed. I could go on and on, but this is one of Bernard's favorite chapters in the Bible, Romans 10. I'm stopping at 12. So I'm asking you all to read the other 8 verses or 8 or 9 verses, because 21 in there. God is faithful in all his ways. Amen and amen. To God be the glory.
Thank you, Jesus. Yeah. This song has been with me since they called me and told me that my brother passed. And I've been So I'm just going to do a little snippet. I'm not going to do a whole lot of it. Just a touch. Lord, you're mighty. 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 What a mighty God we serve. Mighty God we serve. Angel, bow before the mighty God we serve. Say, Lord, you're mighty. 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 Oh. I recognize that our God is powerful. In all his ways, in all his decisions, whether we like him or not. That is who God is. He's a sovereign Lord. We don't tell him what to do. And even as the bishop was reading the hymnal, I could hear my brother say to me, Kenny, preach the word. And don't hold back. So if I come across a little strong today, understand and realize I'm doing what my brother asked me to do. Giving honor to God, who is everything to me. Giving honor to the pastors, the clergy, that's here, first ladies. I don't want to call names because I'm going to miss somebody. So I do what our pastor do and say you, you, and you. All right, let's get into this. Each and every day has 24 hours. Each hour has 60 minutes. Each minute, 60 seconds. This is how time moves from day to day. As long as we're breathing, this is how time will continue to move. But what happens when we're no longer alive? I said, but what happens when we're no longer alive? Have you ever given thought to this? It's times like this that causes us to evaluate ourselves and take a step back from the daily routine. In moments like this, we evaluate the present, the past, and what's to come. I ask each of you, to take a moment and imagine what it might be like to go from death to life. I said it right. From death to life. And I'm going to take a little pause so you can really consider that. Moving from death to life. You see, as I prepared for this service, I evaluated my own life. And I realized that death is just a natural occurrence. Death creates separation. And it may be occurring in our own lives right now. And we don't even recognize it. You see, the death that I'm speaking of is within the spiritual realm. Romans 6 and 23 says, the wages of sin is death. Are you the walking dead among the living? Now let's take a look at our text. Ezekiel 37, verses 11 and 14. Should have had these on a little while ago. And for the sake of time, I'm going to go ahead and read. And it says, "Then he said to me, Son of man, these bones are the people of Israel. They say, our bones are dried up and our hope is gone. We are cut off. Therefore prophesy and say to them, this is what the sovereign Lord says. My people, I'm going to open your graves and bring you up from them. I will bring you back to the land of Israel. Then you, my people, will know that I am the Lord when I open your grave and bring you up from them. I will put my spirit in you and you will live, and I will settle you in your own land. Then you will know that I, the Lord, have spoken, and I have done it, declares the Lord." For a title today, I'll take "From Death to Life." Pray with me. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for your people. God, right now, God, I ask that you would be magnified and everything else be made small. Every hurt, every pain, every sorrow, oh God, there's nothing too big for you. So have your way in us, oh God. Do what you desire to do. Move how you choose to move. And we will give you glory. Even in this situation, we will give you glory. For your word said, give thanks in all things. It says in all things, not for all things, but in all things. In every situation, in every circumstance, we're going to give you thanks, God. So, Father, we just love you. We honor you. And I ask that you would prepare the people to hear and to receive your word. May their hearts be open to you. In your son Jesus' name I pray. Amen. So, y'all, if I take a little pause every now and again, I'm not going to stop. All right. I'm going to do what my brother asked me to do. And that was to preach the word. So the text, the passages and explanations of Ezekiel's vision of dry bones in the valley. To set this up in context, verses 1 through 10 speaks of Ezekiel and the vision he had of being in the valley with dry bones. Many of us have heard this passage of scripture, verses 1 through 10. The scriptures speak of Ezekiel being in a valley, and there have been a whole lot of dry bones, but not just dry bones, lifeless bones scattered about. The Lord questions Ezekiel and he says, can these bones live? And with the right perspective, Ezekiel responds. And he says in so many words, only you know, God. Then the Lord gives Ezekiel instructions to prophesy to the bone. So Ezekiel was obedient and he spoke. And then there was rattling. The bones came together. Muscle and skin began to cover the bones. However, there was no life. Although the bones connected and muscle and skin appeared, life did not. They were simply bodies of clay laying out before him. God gave additional instruction and he told Ezekiel to tell the winds from the north, east, south, and west to breathe life so that these bodies could live. And as he spoke, the bodies began to rise. Because you see, they got what they needed. They got God's breath. God's breath to live. Do you have God's breath? That Ruah breath that gives life. You see, the breath that I'm speaking of is bigger than the oxygen we pull into our lungs. It is that that allows us to know God the Father and have a relationship with Jesus, all the while being guided by the Holy Spirit. I feel my help coming on, so I gotta pump my brakes a little bit here and get back to my text. So this is what Ezekiel has just been shown in his vision. Now get into our text. God wants to break it down a little bit. He wants to make it plain for him. So I'll paraphrase a little bit to make this thing as plain as possible. So it goes a little something like this. God tells Ezekiel, this is Israel, his people, who've lost hope. He further explains that he is going to remove them from dead places. God clearly articulates, you, Israel, will know that I am the Lord once I have done just what I said I was going to do. God doesn't just want to move Israel from dead places, but he desires to give them his spirit so that they may live and live prosperously. God closes this passage of scripture by placing an exclamation point on it. Or as the younger generation might say, he put some respect on it. And said, you'll know because I said it, but beyond the words, I did it. From this passage, we're going to pick up some principles that have been laid out before us. And even one thing, even my mom spoke it. Oftentimes the Bible speaks of Israel, but God is not a respecter of persons. So if he did it for Israel, he can do it for us. So as I get into this word, we must believe God does what he says all the time. I realize that we want what we want, but our desires don't always align with what God has for us. We must also realize we can't force God to do anything. Is there anybody here know that we can't shake down God the Father? And as a matter of principle, we must stand on a few scriptures in order to move forward in this sermon. The first one being Numbers 23 and 19. And it says, God is not human that he should lie, not a human being that he should change his mind. Does he speak and then not act? Does he promise and not fulfill? That's not God. That is God. That is who God is. We must also recognize that Isaiah 55 and 11, and it says, so is my word that goes out from my mouth. It will not return to me empty, but will accomplish what I desire and achieve the purpose for which I sent it. And finally, Acts 10 and 34. It says, then Peter began to speak. I now realize how true it is that God does not show favoritism. Now that we know and have a basis for the principles as we move forward, We realize God does not have favors. He does what he says, and his word never goes out and fails to achieve what it went out for. Using the principle, God doesn't have favors. What God said about Israel, his chosen people, and how he wanted to remove them from dead places, he wants to lift us up from the grips of death, that spiritual death, and cover us in the blood of his son who took stripes for us, who endured pain, who endured a painful death and became sin for us, though he never sinned and was sinless. What he does for one, he'll do for all. Just like he saved me from doing all that I did, he can and wants to save you as well. No matter what you've done, no matter what you said, God still wants you to come to him before it's too late. He's right here waiting for you to simply say with the right heart, with the right perspective, God, forgive me, and your life will be changed. It's as simple as that. God doesn't lie. So whatever he promises you, he'll deliver. Someone here has been given a promise. And whatever that promise is, know that God wants to make good on it. In fact, God will make good on it. God wants relationship with you and I. We need to place him before everything and everyone else. And when we do that, things will fall into place. But however, we can't just run to the Lord like he's our sugar daddy. We can't just run to God like he's a sugar daddy, giving at will and you not being obedient. Oh God. Our God is loving. That when we're hurting, he consoles us. When we're going through, not only is he with us, but he carries us through the challenge as long as we remain focused on him. So this test we're facing today is just a test. Will you believe God? Will you trust him? I've sometimes found myself desiring what I want before I ask God what he wants for me. You see, even in this very situation, I will give thanks. Because the word doesn't say give thanks for the situation. It says give thanks in the situation. So today, give thanks. No matter what challenge you face, give thanks. I know my feelings aren't always aligned with God's will. So you know what I do? I give thanks. Even when I don't understand, I give thanks. even when I feel like I am the dry bone in the valley. I give thanks. You see, sometimes we go through. We got to go through the valley to get to the mountaintop. To get to that high place, we've got to travel that road that may not feel like it's safe taking. That it may not look like it's a safe road. But we shouldn't be ashamed, because God told us not to fear. He told us not to be anxious. He told us not to worry, but to trust Him. So as we move through this test, I encourage you to trust God. Family, trust God. At every turn, trust God. And finally, God does what He says He'll do. He advises us to do according to 1 Peter 5, casting all your cares on Him, for He cares for you. Will you cast your cares on God? In this moment, I offer Christ to anyone bold enough to accept. I realize this is a homegoing, but at some time, at some point, we'll all leave this world. And it is my desire, it is God's desire, that we all know Him. So I'll give an opportunity for my family, for our friends, those I may not know but that knew my brother. I offer you an opportunity in this moment to come to Jesus, for He cares for you. Seeing none, and before I close, I want to say thank you to each and every one of you for supporting our family, for just your phone calls. Even if you didn't say a word, but you came, we appreciate it. May you all be blessed. And know that God the Father, Jesus the Son, and the Holy Spirit loves you. Amen.
Please don't say that I gave up. Just say that I gave in. Don't say that I lost the battle, for it was God's war to lose or to win. Please don't say how good I was, but that I did my best. Just say I tried to do what was right, to give the most I could, not less. Please don't give me wings or halos. That's for God to do. I want no more than I deserve, no extras, just my due. Please don't give flowers or talk in harsh tones. Don't be concerned about me now, for I'm well with God. I made it home. Don't talk about what could have been. It's over and it's done. Just see to all of my family's needs, for my battle has been won. When you draw a picture of me, don't draw me as a saint. Don't draw me as a saint. I've done some good, I've done some wrong, so use all of your paint. Not just the bright and light tones, use some gray and dark. In fact, don't put me down on canvas, just paint me in your heart. Don't just remember all the good times, but remember some of the bad. For life is full of many things. Some of them are happy, and some of them are sad. But if you must do something, then I have one last request. Forgive me for the wrongs that I've done, and with the love that's left, thank God for my soul's resting. Thank God for all of you who loved me, and most of all, praise God, because he loved me best. The family of the Reverend Moses Bernard Maddox wishes to express their most sincere and heartfelt appreciation to each of you who have shared with them during this time of sorrow and bereavement. They thank you for every gesture of love and kindness that has been extended to them. They thank you for words of encouragement, but most of all, they thank you for the prayers that have been prayed for them. It is their prayer that you will continue to pray for them, not just today, but pray for them on tomorrow as they grow stronger and know that we serve a God who is able, one who can do anything but fail. At this time, we wish to acknowledge letters of condolence and floral offering that have been sent for the family. Beulah Grove Baptist Church. The Beulah Grove Baptist Church family unites with you in grief and sorrow as we mourn the passing of your loved one, Reverend Moses B. Maddox. I know that you have suffered a great loss. As believers, we know that Psalms 30 and 5 is true. Weeping may endure for a night, but joy cometh in the morning. Please know that you are not alone and that your Beulah Grove family is here for you. We walk with you and share with you in this most difficult journey. In the bonds of peace, Pastor Xavier Creekmore and the Beulah Grove Baptist Church family. Resolution for Reverend Moses Bernard Maddox, a beloved son, brother, father, and friend. We are today comforted by the words of our Lord in Revelation 21 and 4, which says, "And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. Whereas it has pleased the Almighty God to take unto himself our brother too soon by our measure, but in the providence of an all-knowing God. Therefore, be it resolved that we bow in acceptance of the perfection of God's plan to gather each of us in his merciful arms when we have fulfilled our tasks on this earth. Servant of God, well done. Rest from your love and joy. The battle's been fought, the victory won. Enter thy master's joy." Be it further resolved that a copy of this resolution be given to the family and a copy kept in the church archives. Respectfully submitted on this 30th day in the year of our Lord, 2021, on behalf of the officers and members of the Whole Truth International Ministries Incorporated, Americus, Georgia, Reverend George F. Munch, Jr., Overseer, Senior Pastor. With deepest sympathy, Frank and Lena Lewis. With love and sympathy, Mrs. Imogene Evans and family. You are in our thoughts and prayers, Bishop Arthur Fulton and United Holiness Church. In my prayers, Evangelist B. Snipes. You are in our thoughts and prayers, Overseers George and Deborah Muntz, Whole Truth Ministries. To the Carsons, with love, Charlene Williams. With deepest sympathy, friends and family at the Shopper. With deepest sympathy, Bishop Melvin McCluster and the Friendship Missionary Baptist Church. The family flowers given in loving memory, loving father, son, brother, uncle, cousin, and friend from the family. In loving memory of Dr. Napoleon Williams, Deacon Arthur L. Parker, CEO and President, along with the staff of the J.W. Williams Funeral Home, presents to this family an African-American family heirloom Bible. Just as Reverend Maddox preached the word, we want you to know that the word will be your comfort in the days to come. No matter what you're experiencing, know that the answer is found in the word of God. We're pleased to present to this family a picture or a tribute of your loved one's life. May you cherish all the many memories that you share together as a family, and may those memories forever live on in your hearts. And finally, we present to this family this memorial keepsake blanket. It is our prayer that you wrap yourself in the love that this blanket holds for you. For we know that anyone who has ever loved is never lost. And because Bernard was loved so much, he will forever live on in each of us who have the opportunity to share his life. It is our prayer that you're blessed now and always.
This is a day of salvation. Seek ye the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near, and he will hear you. Earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust. Shall not the judge of all the earth do right? Father, we come now in the name of Jesus. We bless and honor you. We ask, Lord, that you would help us in coming days, that you would help us navigate, trust in you, and know that you are always there for us. We thank you. In Jesus' name we pray.